What is a testing and inspection plan in construction? There's a forgotten tool that I'm going to tell you about that may save you. And there's a general process of things that you should remember as you're setting up your program. So I'm going to talk about the testing and inspection register and the key parts of a good testing and inspection quality program. So if you came to like really learn how to implement and follow these step by step, you came to the right place. Let's do this. So let me just go ahead and tell you that one time I had an amazing experience. And I'm going to shout out one of my homies, one of my favorites, Brent Elliott. Right now he works at DPR. I hope he always does, but if you watch this video in 10 years, I just want you to know, Brent Elliott works at DPR, one of the best superintendents I've ever been around. He and I worked on a research laboratory, a massive project down in Tucson, Arizona, and he was in charge primarily of the testing and the inspections on the project site. Now, really, all the superintendents are in charge, and a project superintendent cannot delegate quality, but he was in charge of the coordination of all of it. And I remember he took this a step above. Now, we created a testing and inspection register. We picked the person on the project site that we thought needed the most experience with this, and they went through all the specs and identified and isolated and highlighted all of the testing requirements, all of the inspection requirements for every spec section, and put it on a register. Okay, so now we knew what we're supposed to do. And Brent took it to another level. Like, he took this area in the conference room and he had a board for his schedules. He had a board for his inspection sign-offs. He had an area for all of the permits, the permit plan table. He had all of the areas mapped out. He had a day plan. I mean, he had this place, actually there's a video on this that I'll link you to. He had this place tricked out, and I was like, whoa, oh my gosh, this is amazing. So I want this for all of you. And this is what it did. He was able to manage the inspections and take care of the inspectors in such a way that we passed our inspections with flying colors and made raving fans out of the inspection team. So let me tell you the steps right now for both. But first, I want to tell you about the testing and inspection register. So imagine the horror of closing up an area or finishing a part of the building and then finding out, oh my gosh, you're not compliant. You didn't finish that spec requirement to do that test. This could be for waterproofing. This could be a test for the roof. This could be for your exterior windows. This could be for all of your toilets in the building to make sure your sanitary sewer system works properly. This could be a number, this could be for your soils under your foundation. And consider the horror. The absolute horror of realizing you're done with this building, you're on time, but now you've got to go back and rip it up and do massive amounts of rework. You get past that by creating a testing and inspection register. You, like I said, go through all of the specs. Anytime you see a scope with a spec section and it says there's a testing or inspection requirement, you take the spec section and you put it in the log and you review this log at least once a month with your team, and somebody owns it. You have an OPUR, O-P-U-R, one person ultimately responsible. So you make sure there is zero chance that you cover anything up without it being tested and inspected, and you can finish that job knowing I am done. There is no way we missed anything, okay? That testing and inspection register will allow everybody to see, everybody to know. You can use it in your pre-construction meetings. You can use it as a part of your inspection process. You can manage it as a part of your team meeting. And if I'm a PM or a super, I ain't sleeping well at night unless I know I have that. That is a tool. I will never build a job without a testing and inspection register. I recommend that for you. You know what else? I will never do any of these videos without trying to add value to you. So if these videos are value add, please like and subscribe. I want you here. These are for you. We spend the time and money for this. Please, let's stay together for future content because these are for you. Thank you. Here's a heart for you. Love you. So now we're going to talk about the key components of a really good testing and inspection plan. But I do want to say, as we've talked about in other videos, which I will link you to in the description below, on how to manage an overall quality process, quality assurance is the designing of quality from the start in the design phase and in your preparation steps. Quality control is the monitoring of the quality execution in the field. So the inspection process really is a quality control function. Okay. And so we must have the right tests performed to verify, and we must have the right inspections to verify that our work is compliant. And if you ever get into a situation where you don't have a city or county inspector, where you don't have an owner's third-party inspector, and it's literally just up to you, make sure you have somebody monitoring this internally, because we do not want to get lax when it comes to quality control. So step number one, clearly identify the scopes of work. In fact, I am going to praise and do a shout out for my Hensel Phelps brothers and sisters. They have this 6-step process, and they have more advanced techniques now. They constantly evolve, but they used to have red folders. And any scope for which there was a preparatory meeting, or what I call a pre-construction meeting, they in that folder literally would take the plan components, the specifications, any related like industry standards, any shop drawings or submittals, any checklists from the company internally, and put them all in these folders under all the different categories so that it could be inspected and so the testing results could be verified. And so they had each of these red folders separated out by scope, and you would literally take the folder out and you could inspect the work. It was absolutely amazing. So when I think about separating out by scope, that's crucial, because if you don't know the different scopes that you want to quality control, then you don't know what pre-construction meetings you're going to have, you don't know what first-in-place inspections you're going to have, and you certainly don't know what needs to be tested or inspected. So start first with scopes and the breakout of those scopes. Two, not only will you rely on the testing and inspection register, but you will rely on the checklist that you create from the pre-construction meetings, from the plans and specs, and any other project documentation or information. So when you're going to go install something, you install it, like I've said before, according to that checklist or that visual that comes out of that pre-construction meeting. You're reviewing the drawings, you're reviewing the specs, you're reviewing them with the trade foreman and superintendent, and the outcome is a checklist that you use to install. Okay. The testing and inspection register will say, hey, this work that you installed, we have to do this test or this inspection, right? So they all work together. And I personally recommend that you, on what I call the feature of work board or the visual for the quality expectations or your checklist, you just list your testing and inspection requirements right there on that quality checklist so the crews know what's coming after. Three, the testing and inspection schedule. This is huge. I personally, for the big items like exterior window testing or for the roof water test or for any major test that we have on the building, I recommend putting those in the schedule so you know when they're going to happen. And not only will you do that, but just like I mentioned in Brent's testing and inspection area up on the wall, you can have a look ahead, literally detailing when you need those inspections, schedule them, plan them, prepare for them. Ooh, and here's a really big point. Let me use water testing as an example. We are not calling out like the third party exterior envelope consultant or the owner's consultant for your window testing or anybody else to do any of these tests just to fail us. So what I used to say is, hey, if we don't know for a fact, like in Arizona, we use Field Verified. Actually, anybody in the country, I highly recommend you use Field Verified for exterior envelope consulting and inspections. There are others, so don't let me make anybody mad, but I use Field Verified. And when they would come out, we know they're going to be thorough. If there's a problem, they're going to find it. So I used to tell our exterior skin and window and metal panel installers, hey, we need to do some random testing and some verification before they arrive. So we have that on the schedule, but not just when are we doing the test, when are we doing the verification ahead of time so that we are not wasting people's time and getting a bad reputation for the owner when we do the final test. Number four, make sure to have a proper documentation process. Sometimes when the inspectors would come out and they would do an inspection, they would have follow-up requirements, or you know, they would say, hey, go ahead and button up that wall, but I want you to confirm dot, 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 or hey, I'll let you start working this area, but you need to do dot, dot, dot. One of the things that I failed with early on in my career is not taking that seriously enough. When you get those inspection reports, either physically or by email or in whatever other format, you have to take them seriously and you have to have a deficiencies log. So whether it was the building envelope with Field Verified, or it was another third party, or it was the inspectors from the authority having jurisdiction, if they had corrective actions, that would go into a central location, documented for action immediately, so we could maintain trust with those inspectors. And finally, I want to say that you will constantly improve your efforts. This is a bare minimum for me. Here's my point. You have to have a culture and a thought and a paradigm of quality at the source. Tell your workers, tell everybody, and actually enforce this on the site. We do not install quality work. Anybody can raise their hand and say, this is not quality. Compare it to the checklist or the visual that I talked about. Anybody can raise their hand and stop the work, stop the crew. We are not going to pass on work. We are not just going to RFI this with the architect and have them accept shoddy work. If we do it wrong, we're going to rip it out and fix it right then and there. Quality at the source. And then even better, prevent it from any defects from ever even happening. If you have a mindset, if we build quality work on this job site and your processes support it, and people know you're not going to pass defective work down the line, you can create a culture that's quite remarkable, that will gain a lot of trust with your inspectors, and that will allow you not only to have a good quality product, but it will enable your schedule, your safety, your morale, and your cost, and pretty much every other key metric on your project site. And so I'm going to link you in the description below to a blog post about this subject that will cover these topics. And one thing I'd like to ask, because when I left, I'll say corporate or actually building with companies, because it's all intellectual property, I left all my files there. So I don't have relevant examples of testing and inspection registers on me today, but I get asked about it all the time. I would love it if any of you have one that you'd like to share with me, send it to me in the comments below. I'd love to share your example, your template, and give you credit. Ultimately, quality is a mindset. Every job should have a testing and inspection register, and every job should have an approach to making sure that we not only build it right, but we test it and we inspect it, and we actually shine when that happens, so the owner has confidence in us. I hope you've enjoyed this video. On we go.